Hey guys, welcome to another episode of the Main Street Moments podcast. This is Kathy.
And Brian.
And, you know, I was reading this article in USA Today. This really surprised me. They did a survey of their readers. Now, that's a national newspaper, USA Today. We all know what it is. They did a poll of the top amusement parks in the country. And Disney Magic Kingdom was not number one. Mm. It was not number two. It was not number three. It barely cracked the top 10. And I was really surprised at this. And I'm going to go down the list real quick from 10 to 1. And while I'm going through the list, see if you can guess what number one is. I was really shocked. Actually, it's a Florida theme park, but not one that I thought would even be in the top 10. It's number one. And Disney Magic Kingdom is number nine. Number nine. Number 10 is Knott's Berry Farm. Now, I've never been there. I know Justin Scar loves Knott's Berry Farm. He goes there all the time. He grew up going to that park. He grew up in Anaheim.
Well, you know,
and he loves that park.
I'm thinking, how many theme parks are there in the country?
400.
That would be at that level. Well,
it says right here 400.
Yeah, but are they like at that level?
North America is home to more than 400 amusement parks and attractions, attracting 375 million visitors annually, according to the International Association of Amusement Parks and Attractions. Mm. So there's many to choose from.
Okay.
Number 10, Knott's Berry Farm. Number 9, Magic Kingdom. 8, Hershey Park. 7, Cedar Point.
Mm-hmm.
You've been there.
I have.
Because you grew up in Ohio. 6, Busch Gardens in Tampa, which is shocking to me. I have not been to Busch Gardens since I was in middle school. That's the early 80s. I didn't like it then. Is it good? I don't know. I haven't been in so long. I remember going there, and it's the they had the Busch Brewery, and I remember taking a tour of that. It absolutely stunk. I was like, ugh, it smelled so bad in there. I don't like beer anyway. And I went there with my mom. I barely remember it. That is number 6. Number 5, Dollywood, which I've heard very good things. My best friend has been there many times. Good things about Dollywood. 4 is Busch Gardens Williamsburg. Now, that looks like a cool place. I love Williamsburg. 3, Kings Island. Have you been there?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. 2 is Silver Dollar City in Branson, Missouri.
Hmm.
That sounds like a really cool place. The only thing I know about Branson is Andy Williams had a yearly Christmas show there, which I wish I would have seen. Number 1, are you guys ready for this? SeaWorld Orlando. Number 1.
Well, that's really
that
shocking.
That blew my mind.
That's really shocking to me. So Magic Kingdom is the only Disney theme park on the
that's
list.
Right, and Universal's not on this list.
I'm very surprised by that.
Now, not in the top 10 anymore.
And I'm surprised about SeaWorld because SeaWorld, a lot of times people don't like SeaWorld because, you know, they have the animals in captivity.
Yeah, that's a problem for me.
Yeah. So I'm a little surprised by that. I would have thought that for sure Universal Studios Orlando and Islands of Adventure would be there.
Especially with Harry Potter, they have the new Hagrid ride. They just added the Jurassic World roller coaster, the Velocicoaster, which is amazing.
No, they have the new Hulk things. Yeah.
So well, that is shocking to me.
I would say Magic Kingdom. It's really shocking. I got to tell you, because I didn't know what this list was until you read through it. I'm really just shocked that Magic Kingdom is the only Disney theme park on the list. But I think the reason...
And it's number 9.
Yeah. I think the reason that Disney isn't really on the list except for Magic Kingdom is because people have a bad taste in their mouth about the expense. It is people, when they think of Walt Disney World... Disneyland not there either. It's shocking because Californians love Disneyland. But when people think of Disney World, they think of money.
Mm-hmm. Well, this is the top 10. So I don't know if the list was bigger and maybe Universal or Hollywood Studios or whatever are further down.
Yeah, but
this
the top
is just
10,
highlighting the top
well,
10.
And I'll tell you, this is also shocking because Orlando, Florida is the number one tourist destination in the entire world. In the entire world, not just theme park. I'm talking about the entire world.
I think Florida, too, is the number one tourist spot.
Because of Orlando.
Orlando and South Beach. I think Florida is probably the
top
spot, too.
Mainly If Florida's number one because of the theme parks in Orlando.
For sure.
So I'm thinking maybe there's a shift going on with people going to Walt Disney World where it's kind of just like because of the expense, it's a one-time expense. And most people don't go back or don't go back for many years because it's just so expensive.
I think there's two factors. I think the expense is the main one. And I think Disney World has become too complicated. You have to reserve everything. You have to reserve for your dinner. You have to reserve to go on a ride. You have to reserve even to meet a character. Everything is takes a reservation. And there was one woman on in a Facebook group I was reading. She's a travel agent, and she, I don't know who she is, but she organized a trip for her friend. And she planned the whole thing for free and all this and planned it to the letter. And her friend did not follow her instructions exactly and ended up having a horrible time, and she was all upset about it. Well, you know, vacations are supposed to be fun and laid back. And they're not supposed to be planned out on a spreadsheet, and you have to go minute to minute by your schedule. Now, some people like to do that. I don't. I like to just go relax and have a good time. I don't like to be on a schedule when I'm on a vacation, but that's how it kind of is with Disney. Everything has to be scheduled at a certain time. You have to show up and be there. It wasn't like that back in the day at all. You would just go, you'd wing it, you have fun, you did whatever you want, you relaxed. Now it's much more complicated. It's much more involved. And I don't think other theme parks are that restrictive with the time and take that much planning. And I think that hurts Disney as well.
Well, Disney, one or two things is going on with Disney with this reservation thing, okay? It's either the executives are so spoiled and have assistants that get everything set up for them that they just think that's how the world goes. Or they have some like Harvard, Yale, MIT statisticians that are working for them that just think this is the coolest thing ever. This all this new business that's going on gives me a headache, all right? Lightning Lane, Genie, I got to make a reservation for the park. And then some rides, I got to come up with a few extra bucks to get in. It's not becoming a magical place. It's becoming work.
I think what they want is they want to have much more control over your vacation. And they want to know where you're going, how many people are with you, and they want to know exactly what's happening, not just for a monetary, but also to handle scheduling with their employees and things like that. I think they want to micromanage your vacation.
Well, one thing
and
with
I think
SeaWorld,
people are getting sick of it.
People that go to SeaWorld, I went to SeaWorld recently, and it was the first time I had been to SeaWorld since I was a little kid. And what most people say about SeaWorld, and SeaWorld is crowded, you know, it's crowded. But what most people that go to SeaWorld, they say a couple things about it. One, they say it's affordable. Even if you have the yearly pass at SeaWorld, it's very affordable. And you got the pass for SeaWorld and Busch Gardens, very affordable. And they also treat the guest to the park as guest. At Walt Disney World, they call us guest, but I feel like I'm a nuisance.
Or you're like just you're just like a cash machine.
Exactly. And Universal Studios Orlando not being on that list, I am in shock because
me too. Universal of Harry Potter.
Mm-hmm, Universal Studios Orlando is, I mean, it's a legendary place. They have the Halloween Horror Nights, which I'm going to this year, and I'm looking forward to that. And that's just a thing that people wait all year for Halloween Horror Nights, and they've got a lot going on in the park. And Universal Orlando, as far as I'm concerned, they treat everyone who attends the park very well, never had a bad experience. And if you're a pass holder at Universal Studios Orlando, there's incredible benefits, and they treat you well. I don't know. I cannot understand how Universal is not on a top 10 list of theme parks in America. Doesn't make sense.
I agree. I'd like to know from you guys, if you've been to SeaWorld, now I haven't been to SeaWorld in a long, long time, but I'm going to want to go back now. If you've been to SeaWorld, why do you think it's number one? What about SeaWorld makes it hit? Now, this was a poll taken by USA Today readers. What about SeaWorld puts it at the number one spot? You said like they have like refillable soda cups. Now, that's not the main
reason.
Throughout the park. But those are the little things that where they don't nickel and dime you. Okay, Disney is nickeling and diming everybody to death. Everything is so, so expensive, and they charge you pretty much for everything. They do have some perks they've added for pass holders, which is nice. If you like, we're going to have our own app, and we're going to have our own little noise when we go into the park, you know, through the pass holder lane.
How exciting.
You know, but
a noise?
Like a little new, like on your magic band, like a special noise just for pass holders or something.
How obnoxious. So I'm in the queue.
Yeah. And when you walk in the park, like, oh, you're home, like a special sound, like, oh, you're
just
special.
Just for pass holders?
Yes.
I'm not going to wear my magic band. I think that's obnoxious. I don't want a special announcement when I go through the gate. I'll feel like a jerk.
I think people want better perks. Okay, so now they came out with the list of rides that'll be covered on the Genie Plus and the cost. Now, Genie Plus, you remember, comes out October 19th. That's when it's going to be available and on the app. Genie Plus is going to be $15 per person. This is the new FastPass system at Walt Disney World. $15 per person per day. And it works like the old FastPass. You make your FastPass, you go on the ride, and then when you get off the ride, you can make your next reservation. You have to wait till you get off to make your next reservation for your next ride.
But it's $15 a person.
It's the same kind of system as the other FastPass, but you pay now $15 per person. And the individual lightning lanes, the prices will fluctuate based on the day and based on how crowded it is. So at Magic Kingdom, the two rides that are the lightning lane are the Mine Train and Space Mountain.
Do they have the prices?
It fluctuates on the lightning lane.
It's
anywhere from like $7 to $12, $13.
Depending on the crowd.
Depending on the crowd. And it might even go up to $20 per person. That's to get the lightning
lane. Now, here's what I'm curious about, okay? Because there's only so many lanes to get into the rides. So Mine Train and Space Mountain won't have the regular Genie. You're going to have to buy the lightning lane.
So if you buy the Genie Plus, which is $15 per person, then if you want to ride Space Mountain or Mine Train, they are not attached to Genie Plus. You have to pay another $10, $12 a person to
nickel
go on those.
And dime.
That's right.
Yeah, this is insane. So the two rides that I think are two of the most popular, right, especially Mine Train
for sure,
aren't even covered by the Genie. So then I got to buy the Lightning Lane. My goodness.
Okay, Epcot, the two rides that are in the Lightning Lane are Remy's Ratatouille Adventure,
of course,
and Frozen Ever After. For now, I guess until Galaxy.
And that starts, is there a date on that?
October 19th.
Okay.
All this starts. That's the Lightning Lane. The other rides are covered on Disney Plus, which is like a fast pass. Hollywood Studios.
You mean Genie Plus?
Genie Plus.
Disney Plus is the television app.
It's so confusing. Hollywood Studios.
That's another thing that Nickel and Diamond is on, where they have a new movie come out and then they want you to pay for premier access.
Hollywood Studios, Rise of the Resistance, and the Runaway Railway are Lightning Lane.
Which basically is a fast pass kind of wait time.
Well, okay. They have the Genie Plus, okay, at Hollywood Studios. And the rides covered on that are like the Aliens, the Beauty and the Beast Live.
Tower of Terror, the
Millennium Falcon, Rock and Roller Coaster, Slinky Dog, Star Tours, Twilight Zone, Toy Story Mania. Those are covered on Genie Plus, which is the Fast Pass.
Can you imagine you got a family with five people?
Lightning Lane, Rise of the Resistance, Railway. Animal Kingdom, of course, Flight of Passage and Everest are Lightning Lane. So if it's in the Lightning Lane, it is not covered on your Genie Plus edition, okay? So if you buy Genie Plus, $15 per person, that does not cover the rides I mentioned in the Lightning Lane. You have to pay more to
go
on those.
I'm going
to
tell you, I shouldn't say this, but I'm going to say it, okay? I've been watching some vloggers this week tell us what a great system this is.
No, it's not.
This sucks. Anybody that says this is good is sucking up to Disney, okay? Because this is now a lot of people, because we're annual pass holders at Disney, okay? So a lot of people that are pass holders may say, oh, okay, I got the free parking. It's almost like not paying to get in because you know, the annual pass charge is like a hidden charge. You don't go and pay when you get there. So if I pay $30 to ride a couple things, it's no big deal. Let me tell you, there are people who will never be able to go to Walt Disney World now, and they're not going to be able to go to Walt Disney World now, and if they, because it's too much money. And if they do, there's this class system going on now. There are people that go with very large families and groups. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you see whole families, they got the t-shirts on, and there's like 15 people, 12 people, you know, and $15, you know, times however many people in the group are going to ride a ride, plus they got the tickets put, and what's going to happen.
It adds up.
Yeah, and what's going to happen is they're going to say, well, there's 10 of us. There's 15 of us. It's just too much money.
That's $150 and, for the Genie Plus right there.
Just for like one ride.
For one day for the Genie Plus.
Yeah, but if they buy the Lightning Lane,
$10 each.
Exactly. Or more, depending on the crowd. And people are going to they're going to be in the park. They're not going to be able to afford it. They're going to be in the queue with their family, and their little kids are going to say, Daddy, we can't afford the Lightning. I mean,
it's called peer pressure.
This is not the dream that Walt had bench.
He would never
with his daughters that day.
No, it is not. And I think what's really crappy is that the Lightning Lane prices are going to fluctuate based on the length of the line. So what they're going to do is if the line is really long and there's a high demand, they'll increase the prices, which I'm assuming. For that line, they can change it in real time.
We talked a couple weeks ago, so I'm not going to get into this too much, but we talked a couple of podcasts ago about how the Disney Genie is going to recommend you do certain things, rides and locations.
That's right.
So they can inflate queue time, wait times in these rides to increase the price for the Lightning Lane. If anyone tells you this is a good system, they're either wealthy, all right, sucking up to Disney, or they just don't know what they're talking about. This is awful.
Well, you know, we did a couple podcasts on the trackers, and I read as many comments as I can, and it's really interesting to see where you guys come from. And a lot of people do not like vloggers that work with the parks because they say that they don't give an honest opinion about Disney World or Universal because they're being comped. And I think there's a lot to be said about that because if you're a vlogger and you're getting media passes and free trips and all this stuff, you're not going to throw them under the bus. And everybody knows that you might say one or two things kind of negative, but not really, just to kind of look like you have credibility. But I think when you are comped things and you get in those good graces, I'm not saying the trackers are like this, but I think there are some vloggers that want that perk, those perks so bad that they will kiss Disney's butt or Universal to stay in their good graces. They're not going to come out and say, look, this is BS. You know, this isn't a good system. And it is BS. I'm sorry. There's no other park. Now, Universal has their Fast Pass system, but it's a one-time fee. It's a one-time fee. And you buy it like, you know, before you get to the park or before
you
go
in.
You can buy it in the park. You can go in and see what the lines are like and wait. And you can buy it in the park, but it's a one-time thing and one and done, and you're good for the whole day. To me, doing it ride by ride and having two separate systems where you pay for the Genie Plus, but a couple rides aren't covered, those are even more money. To me,
total
that's
scam.
BS.
Well, okay, now, the thing about all of this, you know, Kathy and I remember when you used to have to buy the tickets to get on the rides, okay?
In the 70s.
And I remember, I was a little kid, but I remember the tickets for the different rides, you know. The gate price was lower then, and
it was,
I know,
$350.
Yeah, and even adjusted for inflation, it's nowhere near where it is now. So your people are paying a lot of money to get into the parks. They're paying to park, which is $35. Unless they're in preferred parking, then it's $50 right now. They're paying in the hotels and everything else, and then they're getting nickel and dimed by the ride with a gate price that is very, very high. And one of the things about Walt Disney World, because I remember when the ticket system was gone, I'm talking about the ticket system for the individual rides at Walt Disney World was gone, and you paid to get into the park, I can remember going and paying $12 for Florida residents to get in, $18. It's a lot more now, I get it. But one of the things about Walt Disney World that I really enjoyed is you pay whatever it is to get in, and then you don't have to pay to ride anything else. And that's right. Nice. Like sometimes I'll go to our county fair, and it's so frustrating that it's 5 tickets for this, 3 tickets for that, or 4 tickets for this ride. I'm always at the ticket booth. Now I know we got an app and everything, but it adds up. It adds up quick, and it takes a lot of the fun out of it. And as when, you know, our daughter's grown, but when our daughter was a kid and I would take her to the fair and I start looking at these tickets, it was like, oh my goodness, This is awful. And one of the things at Walt Disney World that you see very often is what people call the Disney rage, with the parents are just in a rage. You see,
the fathers.
Yeah. You see mothers and fathers.
Yeah. A lot of fighting.
Get in some really nasty arguments. And the reason that is because it's a humongous expense. And now they've added it. This is almost like Disney is punking us, like they're trolls. It's already stressful for a lot of people because of the expensive day a Walt Disney World visit is. Now they've put in all these other factors that are very stressful. You've got to make a reservation for the park. Hopefully you can get into the park you want to get in.
Now exactly.
Now you got this genie thing. Now you got this lightning lane. They're adding very complicated and expensive things on top of everything else that are very complicated that you're doing on an app and a phone.
But Brian,
and it's not good.
They have the new genie feature on the app to make it so easy for you.
Now, when I go and I'm, you know, if I'm by myself and I'm vlogging, I'll pay $15 to ride Rise of the Resistance because I'm by myself. You know, but if I go to the parks and vlog, I'm typically by myself.
And you only go like once or twice a month.
Yeah, once or twice a month. And since I'm by myself, I'm a pass holder. I've parked for free. I've gotten into the park with my pass. I don't have a big meal because I'm not with the whole family. I just have a couple. So, but if you or I, if you and I are there, Kathy, with the whole family, this has become a huge expense. And think about this: people are going on a vacation, they're there multiple days. So this is an added thing each and every day.
Yeah, like if you know, they do packages, whatever, but if you go to...
They have a lightning lane package?
No, but they... No, I don't think so. But what I'm saying is like they might say they'll give you a discount on tickets. If you go for 4 days in a row, they knock off $50 or something. But you're right. If you have a family of four, okay, say the price of the ticket is $125 each, and that's on the low end.
It's more.
That's on the low end.
It's more than that.
Yeah, so it's like...
$130, $135.
So say it's $550 to get into the park for 1 day for four people. Yeah. Add on another $60 per day for the Genie Plus, and then you have to add on even another $50, $60 if you decide to do the Lightning Lane. You talked about inflation from the time it opened, and I got this article too off Yahoo. The cost of a Disney World vacation has soared more than, how much do you think, since 1971? What percentage?
I have no idea.
3,000%.
Oh, my goodness.
Since 1971, some Jacob Passy at MarketWatch. When the Florida theme park opened 50 years ago, a one-day ticket was $3.50. Today, that same price ranges from $109 to $159, depending on the popularity of the park you visit. The increase is more than five times that of the Consumer Price Index. The cost of other aspects of a trip to Disney World has risen as well. Rooms at the Polynesian and Contemporary cost $453 to $921 a night. That's outrageous.
Yeah.
Up from $29 to $44 in 1970.
Wow.
Now, I know it's $29 in 1970 was, you know, would go a lot further, but what they're saying is...
Not that much.
It also says Disney also used to offer free resort parking. That is true. And I remember when they started charging for parking and we went there and the guy's like, it's $25 a day. And you almost had a heart attack. You're like, wait a minute, this should be free. And oh, no, we don't do that anymore.
Well,
sir.
It used to at the hotels.
Or 50 or 10 or 15
when,
bucks a day.
I remember
whatever
when the value resorts, this is how recent, even when the value resorts, which aren't really value resorts anymore by their prices, but when the value resorts first opened, even then you would park at the hotels for free. And
that's right.
And this was a really cool thing. You would park at the hotels for free, and if you were staying at a hotel, they gave you a paper to put on your dashboard. You got to park at the parks for free.
That's true.
Now you got to pay for both.
And right? That's true. And they no longer give you a free shuttle from the airport. You have to pay for that, which is up could be $30-$40 per person. So this is what they mean by the nickel and diming. And AllEars.net did an article on this exact same survey of the 10 theme parks. And they said the main reason is the cost. That Disney is just other parks offer the same or more for less money. And people are realizing this.
Disney has gotten very arrogant.
And greedy.
And they're taking their guest for granted.
Well, yeah. I think that's apparent. But we still love Disney. In fact, you're going on Saturday.
Yeah.
But, you know, I feel like our experience is a little different than people that travel and go for weeks and weeks at a time. Because, as I've said before, Brian will go for the day and he has an annual pass. And you don't really eat at the park usually.
Don't pay to park.
You just pay for tolls. You don't pay to park. So, it, you know, if you went just for the day, it would cost you like $50 for, you know, because you don't pay to park and you might get a drink or a little snack. And then you pay for gas and tolls. So maybe $75 for the day.
With my Lightning
Lane. And you go like once a month.
Yeah.
So now, though, if you go and you buy Lightning Lane for two rides, you're going to add $30 to that price per day. So I don't think you should do Lightning Lane all the time. But even if you want to go on the other rides, you have to pay $15 to use the Fast Pass system, which is still less expensive than Universal. But I don't think at Universal, if you have the Express Pass, do you have to reserve one ride after the other? You don't have to make reservations. You just go on the ride, right? You just go through the line.
When you in the Fast Pass days?
At Universal. No. At Universal, the Express Pass.
If you have the you can just go to the
ride. You don't have to go on an app and reserve from one ride to the next.
No.
See, that's the thing. Disney is all into reserving things. They really want to know where you are, and I feel they want to have a little too much control over your vacation and controlling your movements, which is what I don't like.
I want to talk a little bit, though, before we go, about Halloween Horror Nights at Universal Studios Orlando, okay? Because I'm going with our daughter and some other family members to Halloween Horror Nights.
She's going to the one in California tonight.
Yeah, that's right.
She's in California right now with friends.
Okay, now here's the thing. I love Halloween Horror Nights, and I'm going to recommend two things to you all who go to Halloween Horror Nights. One, do not watch any videos on YouTube about the houses. The first year I went to Halloween Horror Nights, I didn't see any videos of Halloween Horror Nights, so I didn't know what was coming up in the houses. Mm-hmm. A couple years ago, I went, and I was very excited, so I wanted to watch what the houses were. I didn't get to go in the beginning, and I watched videos on YouTube. I saw the houses, and when I went there, it spoiled it because I wasn't scared because I knew where the scares were coming from.
Yeah.
So first thing I want to tell you to do, my recommendation, take it or leave it, do not watch any videos on YouTube or anywhere else that show you the houses at Halloween Horror Nights. It'll spoil it for you. The other thing is this, and I know this is a bit of an expense, okay? But if you can, for Halloween Horror Nights, buy the Express Pass. Because if you do not have the Express Pass, the lines for some of the houses can be 2 hours long or more. You will not get through the houses. If you have an Express Pass and you get there when the event starts, you can get into every single house.
Yeah.
At Halloween Horror Nights. So get the Express Pass if you can. And we got a really good package deal. You called Universal and set it up, and we got a very good package deal on our Halloween Horror Nights weekend.
Yeah, they have a package deal, and it's for you and Emily are going, and you're meeting my sister and her family up there, and it's for 3 days, 2 nights, and you're staying at Cabana Bay, and they did a whole package with we don't have annual passes anymore, so you're staying at Cabana Bay for 3 days. And then it's two tickets to Halloween Horror Nights and the Express Passes. And for two people, it was like $1,000, which I think is not terrible.
And that's hotel.
Hotel.
Halloween Horror Night
Express
tickets.
Express Pass.
And two Express Passes.
Parking, everything.
Yeah, I know that's not cheap. And it's cheaper
than Disney, though.
And well, the reason we're doing that, usually what we do, we always get the Express Passes for Halloween Horror Nights. Usually what we do is we stay one night. We go the day of. We usually will go on a Saturday. So we'll go up Saturday morning, check in, rest, and go to the event. But I, you know, it's a long day. So this time we're getting a little less thrifty this time. We're going up, and this helps you. We're going up the day before. We're going to go up the day before we're going to go to Halloween Horror Nights, mm-hmm. so that when we go, we don't have to drive there and we're rested.
Right. And I've never I've never done a package thing before.
I didn't even know they offered it. And you got to realize that's for two people, Halloween Horror Nights with the Express Pass. And if you've never been to Halloween Horror Nights, you really should go. I got to tell you, out of all of the special events that I've ever been to at anything, Halloween Horror Nights every year is the best.
Well, you know what? You have to know, because SeaWorld is the number one theme park, and SeaWorld has the Hallow Scream. Don't they?
And you
haven't been to that, so you don't know.
Maybe next year.
Maybe Hallow Scream is better.
I cannot imagine.
SeaWorld being the number one on this list SeaWorld has a really good opportunity to, and it seems like it's already kind of starting, to take some business away from Disney World and even Universal, because it's rated the number one theme park now by USA Today. And they have really good deals on their annual passes. They're not like for a whole year, it's like $200 or something. They have different levels, and they could really do a whole marketing campaign of really going after people, especially Floridians, to get an annual pass and offering a lot of perks. Maybe they do. I don't know. But I think you should think about going to their Halloween event next year.
Maybe.
And seeing what that's like. I'm sure it's fun. I don't know. You know, Universal does everything really top of the line.
It
I know.
Sure is.
But this year, when you go in the houses, there's going to be plexiglass between you and the actors.
It kind of spoils it.
So I wonder how scary it will be with the because of COVID with the plexiglass. So one more thing before we go on to talk about it. If you haven't seen the Muppets show movie on Disney Plus, The Haunted Mansion, it's very good. We watched it Friday night, and it's really cute. I love the Muppets.
I'm not going to do any spoilers for the Muppets Halloween, and that's because it is that good.
It's good.
That's good.
It's definitely better than the Eddie Murphy movie.
Yeah, you know, in the Muppets Halloween, they incorporated so many different things from ride itself,
which is awesome.
I was totally blown away.
Yeah, that's what I thought was really cute, is it's like you go through the ride while you're going through this movie, and it's with Gonzo and Pepe, who I love, and all the other characters. So definitely check that out. The kids will love it. So tell us what you think about SeaWorld being number one and Magic Kingdom being number 9, and why that is, and why Universal is not in the top 10. I'm really interested to see what you guys think. Anyway, everyone, thanks so much for listening. Thanks to all our new subscribers and our previous subscribers. We appreciate all of you, and we will see you in the parks.